My name is David Knight. I am the chair of the British group of IABSE, and it's a real pleasure to welcome you to this webinar this Friday. We are broadcasting live from the UK. I hope it's not quite as cold where you are as it is where we are, but hopefully this will be something to warm you up. The IABSE webinar series is something that goes out internationally, and all of the talks are recorded and available on the IABSE website. But I thought I'd just briefly give you an introduction to IABSE itself. IABSE is the International Association of Bridge and Structural Engineers, and is a organisation that collects together people and thought and research and disseminates and shares that worldwide. It's a great club of people who are keen and interested in the wider construction industry, and hopefully is something that you're all aware of and are interested in joining. It operates in national groups, so we're, as I said, we're members of the British group. Wherever you are, there may well be a national group that runs local events. But these international webinars are available worldwide. I'm going to share my screen just to advertise a couple of upcoming events. The first one is the IABSE Congress, Symposium in Manchester, happening between the 10th and 12th of April 2024. Planning is well underway for this, and it should be a fantastic event. But what I'm pleased to announce is that registration is now open. So please head to iabse.org/Manchester2024 to book your tickets. Preceding that will be a conference aimed at early career designers and architects and engineers called Future of Design. It's an event that the British group has run regularly over the last 15 years or so. But we have associated it this year with the Manchester Symposium to give those coming from abroad an opportunity to attend and to see what that's like. So please do consider joining us for that. And if you're based in the UK, there'll be another Future of Design in London in September. So also a date for your, or a suggestion for your diary, should you wish to do that. This webinar has come about because the British group runs an annual paper competition. The paper competition is called the Nethercot Prize, after the former IABSE president, David Nethercot. And it is a competition that aims to celebrate how we tell stories about the work that we do. So it's a paper, it's a competition that is focused on what the entrant can tell us about a project, how well they tell us, and the process of telling us about it, rather than necessarily the work they did on the job. This year we were delighted to award it to Livia, who I'll introduce in a minute. Just to highlight this, this is a online webinar, and you are very welcome, and please do contribute questions throughout the talk. At the bottom of your screen, there should be a button that says Q&A. And if you would like to ask a question, please put it in there. And then at the end of the talk, I will get to all of that, read the questions out, and get Livia to answer those. But without further ado, really, I'd like to introduce Livia Carmagos Guimaraes, who is a graduate engineer with Pell, Frischmann in the UK. And she will be presenting on Space House, a low carbon reuse of a 1960s icon. And we're all looking very much forward to it. Livia, over to you.
Yeah, thank you, David. I think this is the first webinar of the year as well, so it's a pleasure to be around. Thank you so much for the introduction. I'll just share my screen and get the presentation going. Can we see it okay?
Yeah, that's all good.
Okay, perfect. So Space House was a project that was one of my first few projects at Pell. And I joined in as a graduate about 2 years ago. So my contribution to this was more towards the end in stage four, and it was mostly around the inspection of concrete on the facade and the frontal units as well, which I'll dig into a bit more later. But it's a very interesting, it has a very interesting background, and I'll tell you guys all about it. So the site is located in around Holborn Station. So it's pretty much at the heart of London's theatre land. So a lot of cultural significance, a lot of architectural and artistic significance. So being part of this is much more than just an engineering accolade, but also being part of something that is has a cultural background is really nice. So the building itself, well, the development itself was built back in the 60s, and we had the opportunity to come in as engineers to redo it alongside some other consultants. But essentially the structure of it, there's this tower block, it has 15 stories, and then to the right of it, there's the Kingsway block, and there's 7 stories to it. They're both structurally independent, but they're also linked with this bridge. And this bridge is pretty much connecting it from the first floor and the second floor. And underneath all of this, there's also a 2-story basement. And this, actually, there's a really interesting background story for this. Because essentially, we need to think about how the design was made at the time, and historically in the 60s, we're talking about 15 years after the war. So Britain was still going through an austerity period, and there was a lot of encouragement from the government itself to sort of encourage designers and engineers alike to bring new ideas to the field and get us as leaders in the construction world. So this was the context of it all. And at the time as well, early 60s, late 50s, there was not a lot of office real estate. This was just starting to pick up. It seems a bit like for us, when we're just going in the office every day, we don't stop to actually think that the narrative of all of this, but at the time, it was still starting to pick up. So there was no actual data to prove the developer at the time that having a office space in Holborn would actually be good. So what happened here was they created a speculative office space. So it was meant to be a speculative commercial development. And this 2-story basement was actually a car park because the industry and the automobile industry was also picking up and encouraging people to drive to work. So that was the story behind the basement. But as you can see, it was very underdeveloped. The skyline is not as we know today. And it's mostly because of the commercial boom we had since then. So, and this encouragement from the government also led to other similar creative buildings from the times, such as the Barbican, and a lot of exploration on concrete. So this was difficult at the time. And center points as well, which is also part of Pell's project repertoire. So as I was saying, the context of it all is very creative, very permissive. And it was designed by the architect Richard Siefert and Pell's at the time as well. So we were able to have access to a lot of the information from back in the days, but I'll go into that later. The structure itself is a hybrid precast in situ concrete, and this allowed for a quicker construction time as well. And it was about a week floor cycle time during construction, which is difficult to achieve today, let alone at the time. But this just made the construction flow really nicely. And another innovative thing from an engineering point of view is the facade. So essentially these here, we call it a cruciform unit. So they sort of look like a crucifix, hence the name. And they work as columns and beams. And these were all custom made at the time. So obviously as we're trying to reuse the structure and redevelop with the brief we were given, we had to adapt to a custom-made unit, so it wasn't as straightforward as most of other developments out there. What else? So this was given a grade 2 listed status in 2016. So this is something that implies that we have to be compliant with what the council is expecting as well. So a lot of collaboration with the architects to make sure that that is respected. So the team itself, just giving credit where it's due, project manager and QSs, gardener and Theobald, the client was Seaforest, BAM as the main contractor, Atelier 10 as MEP engineers, environmental consultants, us, Pell's for structural engineering and civil, so doing some drainage work as well, and Squires for the architect. So why should we seek to reuse and redevelop buildings? The answer is quite simply because of sustainability. So the more we look at this as opportunities rather than a challenge, a technical challenge, the more we can get out of it in terms of net zero. So the brief we were given by the client was to modernize a dated building, so quite an old building, and bring it to a modern workplace vibe. And they also wanted to celebrate the historical significance of it. And this was done by mainly exposing the structural elements that were an innovative feature at the time. So, but I'll go into that later as well. And this was a goal to have sort of like a hub to integrate Holborn as well. So if we're bringing up this idea of a modern workplace, we also need to bring up the idea of collaboration. So there's a public realm that was developed downstairs, and the basement was also turned into an events area and some storage space for cycle and parking. So we had to consider quite a few things as engineers. And we were lucky enough to be to have all the contents that we needed in order to make certain, to understand certain things about the reuse. So we were in quite a favorable position, and we were trying our best to reuse with what we had and not bring further damage in terms of sustainability, and also keeping respecting the character of the building. So what we did was we established a few reuse parameters. So firstly, durability. So I understand I'm talking to maybe quite a few Bridges people from the IABSE. So durability is probably something that you guys think a lot. Making sure that the structure is sustaining its design life as it should, and finding opportunities to extend that. So that's what we looked into, durability being one of the most important ones. And if we think about design life in general as well, so if this was made in the 60s, so we're talking about a building that is probably at its end in terms of design life, so how do we mitigate that as well? So strength was another one, a bit of an obvious one, but it's important for us to understand how much residual structural capacity we have and take advantage of it as best as we can. Another one is fire rating. So especially after Grenfell, our industry thought a lot about how to make sure that fire is taken even more seriously. So modern standards at the time in the 60s probably was not as thorough as it is today. So we need to make sure that the fire requirement was met. Serviceability and tolerance as well. So as I was mentioning before, we had the information, the archive information. So to the right here, that's actually a drawing from the 60s that we were able to preserve for all this time. And they actually come in little small microfiche. So you get to digitalize them and see everything in a lot of detail, which is very useful for us. We understand exactly the design intention behind everything. So we did a lot of test study for that, but we also need to make sure that these were made sense on site, if they it performed as it should. So a lot of surveys were actually carried to determine things like floor flatness and headroom, and which could have differed a little bit from the drawing. Creep being another one as well. Another one is foundations. So over time, it's typical that buildings, they can settle a little bit, so they can move and change levels a little bit. So a lot of surveys were taken to make sure that this was as expected. So basically the way that we, so summarizing everything, the steps we took was step one, a desktop analysis, and then shortly after, site verification, so going on site and testing for the things that we were expecting. And then step three, assessing the results and seeing opportunities for reuse. And step four, actually providing the solution. So there's a lot of engineering processes that went through to make sure that we were delivering the best solution. So this is another one, another archive drawing. And we also, we were lucky enough to have the calculations as well. And this is actually perfect because you understand the material grade that was used and exactly the details at which it was designed. So you can understand the overall behavior of the structure. So in terms of loading, there were quite a few loading constraints because it was designed to CP114, which is the design code of the time. So now we use Euro code, so it's a bit different. But the first principles are the same. It's just how much you're allowing for factors of safety and material factors and all of that might have changed a little bit. So there were a little bit of loading constraints to the original design codes. But it was good that we had the information to compare and mitigate as appropriate. Existing material strength as well. So we're able, as I said before, we're able to understand what grades things were designed to predict how the performance was going, if it was performing as it should or not, and also give us a benchmark to copy these the design expectations to the things that we were going to design and follow the brief. So for example, the client required that two extra floors were added. So maybe if I go back to here, we can see, so initially it was 15 stories, but part of the brief was to add a two-story extension to the tower block and a few others as well for the Kingsway. So we had to make sure that the information we had was enough to copy this facade here, which is the cruciform unit. Let's go back here. So that was something to look out for. But again, the information was there. It was just a question of abstracting it and making sense of it as part of the design consideration. So another thing that was a bit of a challenge as well was the HSC concrete. So most of the building is made of concrete and reinforced concrete. And part of the cement that was used was a cement called HSC, which is a high alumina cement concrete. And this essentially now it's banned, so we can't use that anymore. And it was specifically to the rib slab. So this part here is the internal slab, and which is part of the structural system providing support to the frame. So we've got the beams and the columns on the outside, and then the rib slab on the inside, which is also custom designed to make sure it utilizes is strong enough to make sure there's no internal columns, because again, going back to the first few points I made on this, the developer wasn't actually sure that a office space in Holborn would work out. So the flexibility was also something that was really important for the developer at the time. But back to HSC Concrete, this sort of composition cement, BI alumina cement concrete, is banned at the moment. So we had to do understand how it was working and find ways to contour this problem. So the thing with HSC is that it was frequently used in the past in precast because it would achieve a very rapid strength gain. And this is perfect when you're on site and constructing things because the overall program is a bit quicker. But this could no longer be done this time on this development. And although it was good at the time, it comes with a bit of a downfall, which is conversion. Conversion is a phenomena that happens in HSC that as it goes through time, the concrete becomes more porous and leads to a significant reduction in strength. And although this was taken into account at the time, this is something to be aware as well. And another issue as well is that when it's fully converted, it provides a very little corrosion protection to the reinforcement. So over time, you can just understand that as water seeps in, moisture seeps in to the reinforcement, it could cause some rust and some decrease in strength. So what we did to counteract this was to understand the risk. So the Frampo units, they were all on the inside of the building. So it was dry and internal. So the risk is relatively low. However, we did provide some suggestions to the client, which was to keep a inspection every 5 years to check if the material is okay. So that's the CGI view of the slab and the overall structural system of the building. And these columns as well, they're quite interesting. They're my favorite. So another thing to think about is fire. So as I mentioned earlier, the modern fire requirements are a lot more rigorous than it was at the time. And the new fire rating requirements for the main office was a 90 minutes, but at the time it was designed for 60 minutes. And that's what we have as reference in the drawings. And there are three main elements to fire resistance in a structural element. And that is the structural capacity, integrity, and insulation. So in other words, the material has to be strong enough from a structural perspective to make sure that the fire is kept out and the strength is kept the same. And it also has to have integrity, meaning that the element itself needs to be designed uniformly and continuously so the fire doesn't get in. And also insulation, which is related to the surface temperature on the opposite side of the element. So in this case here, for the ribbed slab, it causes a bit of a problem because it has these troughs and peaks, so to speak, and it could keep the fire inside, making compromising the insulation bit of the story. So we had to think about fire compartmentation and the performance of the overall slab. And we found that the ribs were actually too small for standard tabulated base methods. So we went for the Eurocode 2 500 degree isotherm method. And that helped us understand how it was performing and how to make it a bit more safe. That's on fire. In terms of the verifications, as I was mentioning before, it was the first step was the desk study analysis, And the second step would actually go on site and check if the findings from our drawings were the same. So some of the inspections that were carried out was the rebar scans, so checking, going on site, and taking equipment to actually check how the rebar, how it was located and how it was used, and also breaking out a few sections to double check. So if you see the bottom right corner right there, that's what's happening there. And also chloride content and depth of carbonation. So this right here, so that's to check how the concrete is performing. And also the quality of precast was very good. And from our surveys, we were able to find that it was quite resistant to carbonation. And there was also some petrographic analysis of the cruciform unit. And also we did a few material testing by taking some cores out, just like this one, and crushing it and doing some tensile testing for the rebar. So as I was mentioning before, part of this brief was to add two more floors to the tower itself. Now that becomes a bit of a technical challenge because these are all the cruciform units. They are essentially, they were custom made at the time and it was very innovative for the time. So we had to figure out if the structure in itself was strong enough to withhold the extra floors, and how, if not, what should we do to change that and make it the cost efficient. So that was part of it, trying to figure out the residual capacity in the frame to take on these additional floors, and doing it in a way that increases our, sorry, not increases, that is complying to the fire rating, carbonation levels, and all the things that I spoke about before. And we were able to find as well that the tower could accommodate the two additional floors without exceeding the original design loading, which was ideal as we minimized completely the risk of strengthening the columns and the walls at the bottom. And the two floor extension was also preferred by the planners. And so this was seen as a very good sweet spot for a vertical extension. So I'll talk a little bit more about the tower extension. So basically, the proposal, So the proposal for the two additional floors of the tower, it consisted of right there, a level that was had to be similar to the other ones. So it had to follow the historical pattern, the architectural pattern of the tower itself, and that's part of the listed building criteria that I was talking about before as well. So it had to match really similarly. And the way we did that was, again, going back to the drawings and checking for the precast cruciform units and seeing how the rebar was arranged, how can we make sure that the cover was kept safe for fire protection and all the other things I was mentioning before. And also this, the second floor right here, it had a bit of an inset, meaning that it wasn't to the perimeter, it was a bit inwards, and that was done to minimize the visual impact when you view it from the ground. That's it. So just taking you through a few pictures from the cruciform unit journey. So this is the drawing itself from back in the days, from Pell's in the 1960s, and a picture of the cruciform unit as it's being installed. And now fast forward to a few years, well, quite a few years later, a few decades later, we're facing a completely digitalized drawing where we're engaging with manufacturers to get the best design. So you can see how the progression of engineering as well through these pictures. And that's the same. So these are the cruciform units that we had to add to the top levels. And as I said before, they had to be very similar to the other ones. And this was, we liaised very closely with the architects to make sure that we were getting the correct cement mix, the correct cement color, aggregate sizes, and things of that nature, and making sure that everything was compliant to what the council was expecting for this graded list, graded building. So we did that very well. And this is the installation process as well. So there's an aerial view right there to the left of the units being installed. And in terms of net zero, one of the client's brief was to make sure that we minimize the embodied carbon of the structure. And to make sure we did that, there were two things in mind. Making sure that we're reusing the structure as much as possible. So all the things that I spoke before about residual strength capacity, design life, all of these things affecting to make sure that the building can be used again and extending its design life. But also another point to consider is reducing demolition. So we looked into this and worked really closely with the MEP engineers to choose sensible locations for demolition. And this was mostly done in slab penetration to avoid the excessive demolition and recasting of the structure. So to the left here was the original extent of the demolition. And to the right was after we were able to reduce it as much as possible. And one example of this is in the Kingsway Block, so the building to the right of the tower. Originally, there was quite a lot of demolition, and this was caused by large surface risers. And the architect did not want any downstand beams, which meant we had to demolish and recast a larger area of the slab. And we worked with the team to relocate the service risers into more structurally favorable locations. And this essentially led us to trim the steelwork and support the slab around the larger service host. And this avoided a big chunk of the demolition, as you can see there. So in summary, all of this meant that we were able to carry out a building that is actually really performed really well in terms of the embodied carbon of the structure of the whole redevelopment. And we used our own in-house carbon accounting tool to prove this quantitatively. And there was a lot of spare structural capacity identified and utilized. There was also the use of low carbon lightweight in the structure in the bits that we were creating. And in total, there was more than three times lower than the LEED to 2030 target, which is a very good thing. And we also achieved A++ score rating and saving 10,000 tons of embodied carbon. So all of this is a very positive, sustainable narrative as well. Eventually leading us to get a BREEAM outstanding for a grade 2 listed building, which is a big deal. And this was in terms of material efficiency, functional adaptability, flood and surface water management as well. So it wasn't just the structural team that did a good job, it was also the drainage team. And this is just a picture of the people involved. Obviously, there's not everyone in there. I'm missing quite a few of our team members, but just to show that this is not a one man's job and there's a lot of brains behind it, both in our side and all the other consultants as well. So thank you. Thank you so much. Any questions, you can just drop it on the chat and I'll answer them.
Thank you very much. It's great, Livia. Great to hear about such a fascinating project, and it's really good to see reuse expanding as a field. Certainly in London, we're talking about it all the time when we look at new buildings, and this is a key example of that being commercially appropriate, but also technically interesting, but technically appropriate as well. So great to see the details of that. Just as Livia says, if you do have any questions, please put them in the Q&A box, and I will pass them on. But perhaps I'll kick off while you're thinking and while you're typing. And it's obviously an early project for you, Livia. One of the first you've been involved in, and you know, key learning experience as much as anything else. But it's also presumably a learning experience for Pell Frischmann as a company. Are there things within what you've done on this project that you are going to take forward to future projects? And how do you sort of capture that learnt knowledge in an ongoing way?
So is that in terms of like technical things or just anything?
Yeah, well, both, I think, both technical and process, I think, on the project like this.
Okay. Well, I think that first thing that comes to mind is collaboration, understanding exactly how to make use of, you know, all the people in the room, essentially, and having people's strength as well. So collaboration is a huge thing, because you couldn't possibly take responsibility for something that is meaning for the architects or things like that. So having understanding what the scope is and sticking to it and making sure that everyone is fully engaged and perform in bringing the best ideas forward. I think collaboration is the main one, David. Yeah.
Great. Just going to some of the questions that are coming in. Okay. The first question is it still under construction and has it been finished yet? Or when will it finish on site?
I think it's been done in terms of like they're just wrapping things up. It might just open in May, I believe. From memory, that's what it is. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's on its way.
Great. And then sort of follow-up question to that, and I suppose on the concept of reuse, really, the question asks, does the analysis show that a new building would be better than the old one using the technology that we currently have for concrete, or is I think, as you've shown, that the existing is still adequate?
Yeah, no, I think that bringing something that's so historically significant down, just bringing everything down and building something else wouldn't be the best approach. So I think making sure that you're sticking to reuse parameters is the best thing. Yeah, and that goes for things that are not historical as well. Obviously, this has historical value, but things that don't. I think one example that I can think of right now is the whole Oxford Street M&S situation that happened last year. So if we have the opportunity to reuse things, especially things with steel where you can reclaim steel and still make sure that these are used in other parts of the development, that's always a good mindset to have. Never bring everything down, just make sure that you can reuse things.
Do keep asking questions. We've got time to answer them, so please type away if you have one. One of the things that occurred to me whilst watching your presentation is how gorgeous the old drawings are, something that is really reflective, I suppose, of the change of techniques that we have nowadays, moving from hand drawings to BIM. But it must have been quite interesting to work and to examine the old precast and pre-stressing drawings, which are really works of art.
Yeah, I actually had someone recently tell me that it looks like a musical sheet, you know, like with all the musical notes. And I thought that was really funny, because these drawings, they hold so much value and so much proof of evolution in terms of our work. You get to see people's handwritings and the way everything was drawn out before. That's super cool to see. So definitely.
So have you, obviously you're adding to a building, and are you archiving your drawings in the same way so that it all becomes part of the record for the building?
Yeah, well, today we have different ways of processing and storing data. So it's slightly different. We're not keeping things in microfiche anymore. It's interesting to see how things evolved as well from even when you think about auditing in big projects, you need to make sure that the data is being stored appropriately so it can be traced back. So slightly different from back in the 60s where the alterations would be made and then you would just archive things. And it was a little bit harder to trace it back because you're thinking, okay, who's got the drawings? Where is it? Is it in good condition? Now it's a lot easier to track these things. And so it's part of the whole BIM revolution as well.
And one final question from me. Again, any other questions from the floor, please put them in the chat. Often when we're adding floors to existing buildings, we consider a change in material really to keep it light. And I appreciate that architecturally this has quite a strong visual language in the concrete, but was there any thought given to perhaps replicating some of the shapes in timber or in a lightweight material rather than sticking with concrete as a solution?
Interesting question. So I was probably not in the room when that happened because I joined in when it was already stage four. So most of the whole design back and forth, which happens a lot in our sector, I probably wasn't there. But I can imagine that there was some discussion on maybe having the top level, the additional second level in steel to make it lighter possibly. So yeah, I can imagine there might have been some back and forth, but probably not with timber. But yeah.
Well, it's interesting, isn't it, that then you can do extensions that hide the join, or you can do extensions that articulate the join and acknowledge the fact that this is new material and a new part of the building. But they are different architectural approaches, but as structural engineers are a part of that discussion, especially when it comes to material use throughout the structure.
That's right.
We haven't got any more questions, but I think that's been a really good and useful introduction to the building. Thank you, Livia, for all of your work. Thank you for communicating it to us. And I hope that this example of reuse is inspiring to all of those of you working on buildings like this across the world. And I hope to see more of it consistently. Thank you for attending, and catch up with IABSE on its website or check out the other webinars that are recorded and in place, ready for you to view. Thank you very much.
Thank you.